Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Sing out. Let it.
We bless the Lord for a day like this, the fifth day in the seventh month of 2017. The faithful God has kept us for the first 4 days, and in mercy, He has brought you and I to the fifth day. And we all remember that 5 is the number of grace. Therefore, I speak into your life that grace to follow the Lord to the end may you receive today in Jesus' name. Grace to pray and to pray through may it be your portion today in Jesus' name. Grace to serve the Master to the very end. Grace to bring Him pleasure. May it be your portion today in the name of Jesus. Grace to be a role model, a living epistle to this generation. May it be your lot in Jesus' name. Receive grace. Grace to do exploits in the kingdom. Receive today in the name of Jesus. Grace to prosper. Grace to triumph. Receive today in Jesus' name. And so, our Lord and our God, we want to thank you because you are God of grace. Father, we lift you high. We bless you. We worship you. Accept our thanks in Jesus' name. In your name, I've made declaration over the lives of your people. Confirm your word in the name of Jesus. As many as of them that believe that declaration, Lord Jesus, let them manifest the graces in the name of Jesus. Thank you, my King. It is time again to hear from you. Thou the bread of life, feed us in the name of Jesus. We don't want to suffer famine of your word, and that is why we avail ourselves the opportunity to always share of this forum. Lord, feed us in the name of Jesus. Quench our thirst and satisfy our hunger in the name of Jesus. Thank you, blessed Redeemer. Father Almighty, we pray for our Father in the Lord for grace to remain on your side to the very end. Grace to finish well. Grace to finish at your own time. Grace to finish strong, both himself and our mother, the wife. Release this grace upon them in Jesus' name. Grace to satisfy you in the secret and in the open. Lord, bestow on the two of them in the name of Jesus. Grace to follow you to the end. Release on the biological children in Jesus' name. Blessed be your holy name. And for every minister under the influence of my voice, grace to be fruitful, release unto us together, that at the end we will hear, welcome and well done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We bless the Almighty God, the wonder-working God, who have made it possible for you and I to be together at this forum. Today being Wednesday, 5th July. Our topic is in form of a question. Limited to sweet experiences. Limited to sweet experiences. Our memory verse is taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 7. 2 Corinthians 1, 7. And our hope of you is steadfast, knowing that as ye are partakers of the sufferings, so shall ye be also of the consolation. which means if we suffer with him, we'll be glorified with him. Failure to suffer with him will result to not being part of those who will be glorified at the end. Our text is found in Deuteronomy 8, 2 to 7, and Hebrews 2, 9 and 10. We read first Deuteronomy 8, 2 to 7. And thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God fled, led this 40 years in the wilderness to humble thee and to prove thee, to know what was in thy heart, whether thou wouldest keep his commandment or not. And he humbled thee and suffered thee to hunger and fed thee with manna, which thou knewest not, neither did thy father know, thy fathers know, that he might make thee know that man doth not live by bread only, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord doth man live. Verse 4. Thy raiment waxed not old upon thee, neither did thy foot swell these 40 years. Thou shalt also consider in thy heart that as a man chasteneth his son, so the Lord thy God chasteneth thee. Therefore, thou shalt keep the commandments of the Lord thy God, to walk in his ways and to fear him. For the Lord thy God bringeth thee into a good land, a land of brooks of water, of fountains and depths that spring out of valleys and hills. We are still coming back there, but let's go to Hebrews 2, 9 and 10. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9 and 10. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angel for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, should taste death for every man. For it became him, for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons unto glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. Where we first read in Deuteronomy 8, 2 to 7. I want to draw our attention to verse 2. It says, and thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God led thee these 40 years in the wilderness. To do what? To humble thee and to prove thee, to know what was in thy heart, whether thou wouldest keep his commandment or no. I just want us to know that at times problems persist, not because God cannot solve them. Like we learned a few days ago, when we pray and pray and pray, God will answer. There are times we pray and pray, we fast, we cry, we do everything we know how to do. Nothing happens. What could be responsible for it? It might be a way of God humbling us. It might be a way of God proving us to know what is in our hearts. Because some of us, when things are working well, see Jesus, loving Jesus, how wonderful you are. That's our song. But the moment things are hard, we now begin to doubt his existence. We now begin to doubt that love. We now begin to doubt whether he hears and answers prayers at all. Some of us might even be deceived by the enemy and we begin to think of alternatives. It's as if this God is taking too much long. Let me help myself. If God will not help me after all, let me help myself. Or some men may be promising us help, They be telling us they know one juju man somewhere, they know one sangoma somewhere, they know one false prophet somewhere, one with spirit of divination, whatever he says come to pass. God might allow some problem to persist. God might allow suffering in our lives. Why? Because he wants to know what is in our heart. He wants to prove us. He wants to prove us. He wants to test us. He wants to see, but maybe like Job, you'll be able to say, though he slay me, I will yet praise him. It doesn't matter. If I ask him for this and he's not giving it to me, may his name still be praised. I will still hold on to him. I will still serve him. My brother, my sister, one thing I know, God is faithful. One thing I'm sure of, he has our interests at heart. He wants his well with us. He said in Jeremiah 29:11 that his thought towards us are thought of good and not of evil. So at times when we have to suffer, at times when there is a delay, at times when things are not working our way, let's remember God might be trying to test us, to prove us, to know what is in our hearts. What will he find? Will he find doubts there? Will he find a thought of going for alternatives there? Or will he find us solidly still holding on to him? Jesus is the great shepherd, and he wants his disciples, his sheep, to eat and drink from that which he provides for them. If you hunger and thirst after righteousness, you will be filled. How am I so sure? Forever, O Lord, your word is settled in heaven. Whatever you can find written in the word of God cannot but come to pass. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 6. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. But my question is, my brother, my sister, my viewers out there, what do you thirst after? What are you hungry for? Many of us, we are hungry for wealth. And that is why we do all things, whatever it is, just to get wealth. Manipulate figures, tell lies. It's better to hunger and thirst after spiritual things, things that are of eternal value, than ephemeral things of the world. After all, what do we bring to the world? What are we going to take out of the world? By the time you get all the wealth, what are we going to do with it? Blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness, because they shall be filled. God will never deny them. If your cravings is just to know him more, you desire a closer walk with him, you want to do his will, you want to be an extension of his end, he will tell you, my son, my daughter, I've been waiting for so long. Thank God that you finally desire me. Here am I, and he will feel such. In other words, you will experience the right growth in the kingdom when you are receptive and not selective for what the master gives. If you hunger and thirst after righteousness, he will fill you. But you have to take note. For him to fill you, it depends on your ability to receive. You should be receptive. You are ready for whatever he's bringing. Not that, no. I want this, I don't want that. I believe in giving, I don't believe in restitution. I believe in tithing First fruits, no, out of the way. I believe in working for God, but I don't believe in taking Holy Communion. No, you can't be choosy. You can't be choosy. Daddy is saying you need to be receptive for you to have the right growth in the kingdom. You are not to be selective of what the master gives. All that he has to offer, you must be ready to take. Every good word of God counts in helping you grow to become like Jesus. 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. All scriptures is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. So none of the word must be thrown away. Daddy says every good word of God counts in helping you grow to become more like Jesus. In the church of God today, under the guise of grace or liberty, found in the New Testament, a lot of funny things are happening. Some people choose to read only the New Testament and call the Old Testament stale or outdated. It's a sign that they are still spiritual babes. It's a sign that they have refused to grow. Because any mature Christian, we know that both the Old and New Testament are meant for our good. No wonder Hebrews 6:1 says, therefore, living the principle of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on unto perfection, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith towards God. We are to move higher, we are to grow, we are to become mature, we are to become perfect. And there's no way we can attain that without balancing the world. Everything written in the Old Testament and the New Testament are what we need to make us to grow. But for us to say that the Old Testament is outdated, it will surprise you and amaze you that those who say that Old Testament are outdated, they want to stick to New Testament alone, they still lay claim on some of the promises, on some of the word of God written in the Old Testament. For instance, Psalm 23, verse 1 says, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Such people still claim, God, you are my shepherd, I shall not want. And because you are my shepherd, lack must be forbidden in my life. But that is written in the Old Testament. Such people still lay claim on Deuteronomy 28:13. Then you begin to wonder who is deceiving who. But this fellow said that Old Testament is outdated. How come that Deuteronomy 13 is not outdated? And what is it that is written there? And the Lord shall make thee the head and not the tail. And thou shalt be above only, and thou shalt not be beneath. These same people claim that Old Testament is outdated. You hear them pray, Father, your word says, I shall be head and not the tail. I shall be above only and never be beneath. It's time for me to be promoted. Remember me. Touch my MD. Do this, do that. And yet they claim that Old Testament is outdated. Or at times you find them claiming the same Deuteronomy chapter 7 and verse 14. Saying that they forbid barrenness in their life. Never. God, that is not your plan for me. I'm your child. I will never be barren because the word says, I shall never be barren. But where do we find that one written? Of course, Deuteronomy 7:14. Thou shalt be blessed above all people. There shall not be male or female barren among you or among your cattle. Or you find the same set of people claiming the word of God written in Psalm 91 verse 7 and 8. Psalm 91 verse 7 and 8. Which says, a thousand shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand. But it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thy hand shall thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. They claim that. And they hear about terrible happenings in the world. Say, God, God forbid. That will not be my portion. The word of God has said, a thousand shall fall at my side, and 10,000 at my right hand. He shall never come nigh me. Never. Where was it written? In the Old Testament. So what we are saying is that you need every written word of God in both Old Testament and the New Testament to grow and to become what God wants you to be in life. Some others choose to read only specific portions of the Bible that speak of blessings, while they never go to the portions on sacrifice and curses. Some people never want to see passages on tithes and offering and other forms of giving, believing that offering do not go to God but to men. Some of such people prefer to donate their tithes to the poor and needy rather than to pay it as tithes in their church. Such tendencies will definitely affect their growth and hinder them from enjoying God's full blessings. Mark 10, 29 to 30. And Jesus answered and said, verily I say unto you, there is no man that hath left house or brethren or sister or father or mother or wife or children or lands for my sake and the gospel's, but he shall receive an hundredfold now in this time, houses and brethren and sisters and mothers and children and lands with persecutions, and in the world to come, eternal life. From the above scripture, we see that the Lord Jesus Christ did not promise us a life free of hardship. Anyone who goes through life experiencing only pleasure, abundance, and happiness without any moment of sorrow, sadness, denial, lack, or disappointment will not develop a strong, well-balanced character. Such a person will be vain, will lack compassion for others, and be conceited. God allows us to go through both the ups and downs of life so that we can truly fit into his plan for us. That's done. Philippians 4:10-13. A one-sided spiritual diet leads to uneven spiritual growth. Romans 5:3 says that tribulations help us develop patience. Hebrews 2:10 tells us that our Lord Jesus Christ himself was made perfect through sufferings. How can you then become perfect without undergoing hardship? 1 Peter 4:13 says that when we partake of Christ's sufferings, we shall also partake of his glory that shall be revealed. You need to see all that Paul went through. It's because of this knowledge that he knew Christ suffered, we too should be willing to suffer, that he endured all those troubles, written for us in 2 Corinthians 11:22-27. 2 Corinthians 11:22-27. And when you see the list, this same Paul said in Romans 8:35-39, what is it that shall separate us from the love of God? Nothing. Nothing. So we too should be like him, ready to suffer for the kingdom's sake, ready to suffer for the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, because we know when we suffer with him, definitely we will be glorified with him. Don't let anyone deceive you. You need to take in every truth of God's word in order to become who you are created to be. So, if anybody tells you that coming to Christ, everything will be on a platter of gold, no more problem, it's a lie. For you to be balanced, you have to pass through the up and downs of life. You have to taste a bit of the bitter side of life so that God can develop you. We have been told that tribulations help us to develop patience. Key point. God allows his children to go through difficulties in order to develop their character. Take notes. He allows it. Like I said, sometimes that when you are having problems, some challenges, you are prayed, you have cried, you have fasted, you have given violent offering, you have done all you know how to do, the problem passes. It's not because God cannot solve that problem. At times, he may want to prove you to know what is inside of you. At times, he may want to build you strong, build strong character in you, develop your faith, your trust in him, your ability to weather storm. Remember, the Bible says, if you fall in the day of adversity, your strength is small. If God wants to strengthen you, he will allow you to pass through adversity, turbulent time. Your ability to stand and say, no matter what, Lord, here am I with you. I have no other place to go. Proverbs 24:10, as we want to pray, it says, if thou faint in the day of adversity, thy strength is small. Just remember the key point for today, that God allows his children, remember, not his enemy, his children, to go through difficulties in order to develop their character. So I don't know what you are passing through right now. And that's why I want you to pray. Father, please help me to go through difficult times without complaining. I don't want to complain any longer. I don't want to grumble any longer. I now realize that you allowed difficult times in order to develop me. Please, Lord, help me. Oh God, like you have the saint of old. You help Peter, you help Paul. You have the saint of old to endure for you. You help James, you help John. Papa, help me. Help me never to complain. Help me never to grumble. Whenever you allow me, Father, to go through difficult time, in order to develop my character, help me never to complain. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Jehovah God, we join our faith together to pray for all your children that may be passing through difficult phases in their life now. Help them in the name of Jesus. Lord, help them in the name of Jesus. The grace to rest on your love. Lord, release upon them in Jesus' name. Thank you, everlasting Redeemer. Glory be to your holy name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Can we please sing in 14?
floodgates of heaven. Let it rain. Let it rain. Open the floodgates of heaven. Sing out. Let it rain.